Yeah. Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Bhagavate Vasudevaya.
Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya.
Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. from Bhagavad Gita as it is, chapter 4, Transcendental Knowledge. Text number 35. Yajgyadvanapunermoham
Yajgyadvanapunermoham
Evam yasyasi pandava
Evam yasyasi pandava
Yena bhutani yasheshani
Yena bhutani yasheshani
Drakshyasyasi atmani yatomai
Drakshyasyasi atmani yatomai
Yajgyadvana punermoham
Yajgyadvana punermoham
Evam yasyasi pandava
Evam yasyasi pandava
Yena bhutani yasheshani
Yena bhutani yasheshani
Drakshyasyasi atmani yatomai
Drakshyasyasi atmani yatomai
Yajgyadvana punermoham
Yajgyadvana punermoham
Evam yasyasi pandava
Evam yasyasi pandava
Yena bhutani yasheshani
Yena bhutani yasheshani
Drakshyasi atmani yatomai
Drakshyasi atmani yatomai
Yajñātvana punarmoham
Yajñātvana punarmoham
Evam yasyasi pandava
Evam yasyasi pandava
Yena bhutani yasheshani
Yena bhutani yasheshani
Drakshyasi atmani yatomai
Drakshyasi atmani yatomai
Yajñātvana punarmoham
Yajñātvana punarmoham
Evam yasyasi pandava
Evam yasyasi pandava
Yena bhutani yasheshani
Yena bhutani yasheshani
Drakshyasi atmani yatomai
Drakshyasi atmani yatomai
Yajñātvana punarmoham
Having obtained real knowledge from a self-realized soul, you will never again fall into such delusion. For by this knowledge, you will see that all living beings are but part of the Supreme, or in other words, that they are mine. Please repeat. Having obtained real knowledge, from a self-realized soul, you will never again fall into such illusion. For by this knowledge, you will see that all living beings are but part of the Supreme, or in other words, that they are mine. Purport by His Divine Grace, A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami, Srila Prabhupada. The result of receiving knowledge from a self-realized soul, or one who knows things as they are, is learning that all living beings are parts and parcels of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Lord Sri Krishna. The sense of existence separate from Krishna is called Maya, Ma, not, Ya, this. Some think that we have nothing to do with Krishna, that Krishna is only a great historical personality, and that the Absolute is the impersonal Brahman. Factually, as it is stated in the Bhagavad Gita, this impersonal Brahman is the personal effulgence of Krishna. Krishna, as the Supreme Personality of Godhead, is the cause of everything. In the Brahma Samhita, it is clearly stated that Krishna is the Supreme Personality of Godhead, the cause of all causes. Even the millions of incarnations are only His different expansions. Similarly, the living entities are also expansions of Krishna. The Mayavadi philosophers wrongly think that Krishna loses His own separate existence in His many expansions. This thought is material in nature. We have experience in the material world that a thing, when fragmentally distributed, loses its own original identity. But the Mayavadi philosophers fail to understand that Absolute means that 1 + 1 is equal to 1, and that 1 - 1 also equal 1. Thus, this is the case in the Absolute world. There's more to the purport. We'll like to comment on the first paragraph. Omagyana Timarandasya Gyananjana Shalakaya Chaksur Militam Yena Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha Shri Chaitanya Manovistam Stapitam Yena Bhutale Swayam Rupakadam Ayam Tadati Swapadantikam Vandeham Shri Guru Shri Yata Pada Kamalam Shri Gurun Vaishnavamscha Shri Rupam Sakrajatam Sahagana Ragna Tanvitam Tam Sachevam Sadvaitam Savadutam Parijana Sahitam Krishna Chaitanya Devam Shri Radha Krishna Padam Sahagana Lalita Shri Vishakha Nitamscha He Krishna Karna Sindhu Dina Bandhu Jagatpade Gopesha Gopika Kanta Radha Kanta Namostate Tapta Kanchana Gorange Radhe Vrindavaneshwari Vrishabhanustate Devi Pranamami Hari Priye Vanchakampata Rupyasya Kripa Sindhu Paeva Cha Patitanam Bhavanebhyo Vaishnavibhyo Namo Namah. Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadadhar Shri Vasadi Gaur Bhaktavinda. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. So this verse, it follows, of course, what is a very well-known verse in the Bhagavad Gita. The earlier verse, chapter 4, text 34, describes that one can learn the truth by approaching a spiritual master. In this fourth chapter, Lord Krishna had been describing many different ways in which we can perform sacrifices. And he explains that the purpose of all sacrifice was to receive transcendental knowledge. Now, what is that transcendental knowledge is being described to us in this verse. Lord Krishna described that sacrifice has to be performed, should never be given up. There is sacrifice of possessions and there is sacrifice of knowledge. Of the two, sacrifice of knowledge was superior, because sacrifice of knowledge will allow us to understand our factual position. Then sacrifice of knowledge is achieved by approaching the spiritual master. And the spiritual master has realized the truth and he can reveal it to us. Now, Lord Krishna is describing what is that knowledge. It is mentioned here that everything is in me and I am in him. Everything is mine. The Lord Krishna is described here as being the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Remember, Lord Krishna is speaking these words himself. Lord Krishna is saying everything is mine. It's not just a claim. It's not just his ambition, but it is the factual truth. It is the absolute truth. In the commentary, Srila Prabhupada says, many people do not understand who is Krishna. They think Krishna is just some great person in history. And we think Krishna died. We think Krishna was a king and he died. He was shot in the foot by an arrow and died. So these are all misconceptions by people who have lesser knowledge, who don't have proper information about the actual position of Lord Krishna. Srila Prabhupada goes on to say that some people think that the impersonal Brahman is the absolute truth. But those people who have proper knowledge understand what is the actual position of the Brahman. Krishna is not an ordinary person. His birth is not ordinary. We have all taken birth, but none of us were born in a manner in which Lord Krishna was born. When Lord Krishna appeared in this world, he appeared in his four-armed form, fully decorated with jewels and ornaments and crown and turban. He was fully dressed. None of us were born in such a condition. Lord Krishna is not an ordinary person. Lord Krishna himself describes abhijananti mammudha manushim tanamashrita param bhava majananto mamabhuta maheshwara. The foolish mock at me, descending amongst them like an ordinary person. They do not know my transcendental nature and my supreme dominion over all that be. So, foolish people are thinking Krishna is an ordinary person. But the great souls, the Mahatmas, they actually understand the position of Krishna and they surrender themselves to Krishna. If we think Krishna is just an ordinary person in history, this is not the proper understanding. Krishna is in history, but not in history like some ordinary person. Ordinary people, by their karma, they become famous, but ultimately they also die. So Krishna appears in this world not like an ordinary person to become famous by his karma. Lord Krishna is the controller of karma. Everything comes from him. Srila Prabhupada refers to the Brahma Samhita. Brahma Samhita is a very important text for the Vaishnavas. Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, when he was traveling in South India, visited one temple called the Adi Keshava Temple. And in that temple, he was very happy to come across the Sri Brahma Samhita. Just one chapter of the Brahma Samhita. And apparently there are many other chapters. Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu was able to find the fifth chapter of this Brahma Samhita. And he had it copied. And he brought it back with him to Jagannath Puri. And when he came back to Jagannath Puri, he had more copies made of the text. And he distributed it to all of his associates, to people like Ramananda Rai and Swarup Damodar, and to people like Rupa and Sanatana Goswami, all of the different devotees who were there in Jagannath Puri. They were advised by Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu to study this Brahma Samhita very carefully. Because Lord Chaitanya said, this Brahma Samhita is the essence of all of the Vaishnava philosophy. So the very first verse of the Brahma Samhita describes Ishvara Parama Krishna
Satchitananda Vigraha Anadiyadi Govinda Sarvakarana Karanam.
Yes, very good. Lord Krishna has a body which is eternal, full of bliss and knowledge. He is the origin of all origins and the cause of all causes. Everything comes from him. And of course, Lord Krishna has also stated this in the Bhagavad Gita. Aham sarvasya prabhavo
sarva prabhavate iti marva vajante ma udarava samanita.
Lord Krishna said, I am the source of the material and the spiritual worlds. The wise who know this worship me with all their hearts. So Lord Krishna is explaining to all of us in the words of the Bhagavad Gita that he is the source of everything. He is not just simply an ordinary person who appears in this world under the laws of karma and suffers and enjoys according to some past karma. Lord Krishna is the Supreme Personality of Godhead. And that impersonal Brahman, which people think to be the Supreme, that is actually the effulgence coming from his body. This whole material creation is but a shadow of the impersonal Brahman. And then Lord Krishna is responsible for the manifestation of this material world. So it is simply foolishness to think that Krishna is just an ordinary person in history. One who actually knows will understand the position of Krishna. And we see in the Bhagavad Gita, when Krishna speaks these words to Arjuna, Arjuna will reply that not only does he accept this, but also people like Asita, Devala, Vyasa, that they also agree that Krishna is the Supreme Person above everything. We are Brahman, but Krishna is Para-Brahman. We are tiny sparks of the Supreme Brahman. Because we are tiny sparks, so we are parts and parcels of that Supreme Person, Krishna. In Bhagavad Gita, Krishna also mentions this. Mam evam sajiva loke jiva bhuta sanatana manashastani indriyani. The living entities are my eternal parts and partials. Due to conditioned life, they are struggling very hard with the senses, including the mind. So we have a relationship with the Supreme Lord Krishna. Just like the body, the hand is a part of the body. It has a relationship with the body. So long as the hand is attached to the body, it performs many valuable functions. But the same hand, when it is cut off from the body, is useless, cannot do anything. I had one friend who was working in a hospital, a medical surgeon, and he told me that on one occasion they had to amputate someone's leg. And he said as soon as the leg was cut off from the body, then they just wanted to get rid of it, get it out of here, put it in the garbage. But so long as the leg is attached to the body, it's very important, very valuable. In a similar way, all of us living entities are parts and parcels of the Supreme Lord. Part and parcel. I mean, we have the qualities, but in different quantity. Just like the spark and the fire, or the drop of water and the ocean, or the speck of gold in the gold mine. We have the qualities, but in a different quantity. Because we don't have the same quantity, therefore we are described as tatastha shakti. We are the marginal energy of the Lord. And we easily become overwhelmed by the material nature. But Krishna, the Supreme Personality of Godhead, is never overwhelmed by the material nature. This material nature is under his control. Mayadyakshena prakriti suyate sacharacharam hetunanena kundeya jagat viparavartate. This material nature is moving under my direction, O son of Kunti. The material nature is not independent. It's under control. And the example is given that just like the shadow is under the control of the object. If you see some shadow on the floor, the shadow moves when the object moves. And similarly, the material nature is like the shadow of the potency, shadow of the energy of the Supreme Lord. It's under his control. This was also realized by Śrīla Vyāsadeva. In the Srimad Bhagavatam, in the first canto, we can hear how Śrīla Vyāsadeva was feeling discontent. Śrīla Vyāsadeva was dissatisfied after writing many books. He had divided the one Veda into four, and he had written the supplements to the Vedas, 18 Puranas, 6 for the mode of goodness, 6 for the mode of passion, and 6 for the mode of ignorance. He had written Mahabharata, a very voluminous text. He had written so much, but he did not feel peace of mind. He had compiled also, of course, Vedanta Sutra, but it did not give him the peace of mind he expected to achieve. And it was at that time Narada Muni came to him, and Narada Muni instructed him as the spiritual master. Sri Narada Ji told Vyasadeva, the problem is you have not properly glorified the position of the personality of God. Unless we recognize Krishna as the supreme personality, we will never be satisfied and we can never be successful, no matter what we do. And there may appear to be some pleasure, some happiness there, but it will be very temporary. That is the nature of pleasure in the material world. Flickering, temporary pleasure. This material world is actually not a place for pleasure. We are trying to find pleasure here, but actually there is no real pleasure here. The pleasure is not found in the body. The real pleasure is found in the soul. If we want pleasure, we have to connect ourselves to Krishna. So Srila Vyasadeva was instructed by Narada Muni that you have to properly glorify the process of devotional service. And after taking this instruction from Narada, then Srila Vyasadeva first of all sat in meditation. And he was meditating on the Supreme Personality of Godhead. And at that time, the Lord appeared to him along with his different potencies. And Vyasadeva saw the Lord with all of his energies under his full control. So material nature is not independent. It does not act independently of the Supreme Lord. It is controlled. And we are also under the control of the Lord. Just as the material nature is prakriti, the living entities are also prakriti. There are two kinds of prakriti. There is the conscious living entities, and then there's the dull matter. The table, the buildings, our motor cars, they're all matter. They're dull prakriti. They can act only under the influence of the superior prakriti, the living entities. Living entities have consciousness. Dull matter has no consciousness. The car does not run on its own. It needs a driver. It takes a person to transform a building. It takes a person to take the elements and create a structure. So, the conscious living entities are superior to dull matter. But we are still prakriti. We are also nature. We are under the control of the Purusha. There is prakriti and Purusha. We are thinking we are Purusha. In Hindi, of course, men are called Purusha. But who is the actual Purusha? There is only one Purusha, and that is Lord Sri Krishna. He is the ultimate enjoyer, and we are all subordinate to him. We are thinking we are independent, but the fact is we are totally under the control of the Supreme Lord. We did not decide when we would take our birth, and we do not decide when we will die. But we are all forced to meet old age, disease, and death. We don't want these things, but we are forced to accept them. So how can we say we are the controller? How can we think we are Purush? We are simply Prakriti. We are meant for the service of the Supreme. This is the subject matter of Bhagavad Gita, that we have this human body, we're meant to use this human body in the service of the Supreme Lord. The human life is given as a special facility for investigation and inquiry into the Absolute Truth. Without using the human life for this purpose, then we are simply Dvipada Pashu. Two-legged animals. The animals are also busy in the matter of filling the belly and making their homes and having their families. That is not human life. Human life begins when we inquire into the nature of the Absolute Truth. As mentioned by Vyasadeva in his Vedanta Sutra, Atato Brahma Jignasa. Tato means now. Now that we have this human form of life, we should inquire what is matter and what is spirit. So Lord Krishna is speaking in a similar manner here in this verse in Bhagavad Gita. You want to know what is the Absolute Truth? Here, it is mentioned here. You will know that all living beings are but part of the Supreme. In other words, that they are mine. All living beings. That includes us. We are also living beings. We are also Krishna's. We are meant for His service. We belong to Him. We have a relationship with Him. And that relationship is just like as the master and the servant. We have to understand our constitutional position. The problem comes due to illusion, maya, that we are thinking, I am the controller, I am the enjoyer. We are thinking, this world is mine, this belongs to me. We are thinking, I am this body. This is the cause of our problems. This is our ignorance. Just like in the darkness of night, that we do not know what is before us. We don't know what is happening. We feel insecure. So we have to come out of the dark, come to the light. The Veda said, Tamasi ma jyotirgama. See, we're opening the altar. The light is coming. See, we feel peace of mind. We feel happiness. We feel joy. We feel comfort. In the light, we can relax. In the dark, we're in ignorance. So illusion is that. In Chaitanya Charitamrita, it is stated, Krishna Suryasam Mayaya Andhakar. Yahan Krishna Tahannahi Mayaya Adhikar. Krishna is like the sun, and Maya is like darkness. Where there is Krishna, there is no darkness. There is no ignorance. Just like in the absence of the sun, there is darkness. But when the sun comes out, there's no darkness. In the same way, when Krishna is there, consciousness of Krishna is there, then there is no ignorance. The ignorance is due to forgetfulness of Krishna. We have all come to the Krishna consciousness movement. We're all here this evening in order to awaken our original consciousness of Krishna. By nature, we are all pure spirit souls, part and parcel of Krishna. Ignorance, we're thinking, I am the body. We're identifying with this body and everything in relation to the body. Now, we have a body. That is not wrong. But we have to understand the relationship of this body. It is mentioned, as described in this verse. With transcendental knowledge, we will know that all beings are in me and are mine. We are the property of Krishna. We're meant to recognize our relationship with Krishna. This is called Sambandha Jnana. Sambandha Jnana, knowledge of the relationship. Due to false ego, due to ahankar, we are thinking I and mine. I am the body and this is mine. This is called ahankar, false ego. But there is true ego, pure ego, is to understand I am not the body, I am living in the body. I am the soul living in the body. And I am part and parcel of Lord Krishna. This is pure ego. We can awaken this pure ego by practice of Krishna consciousness, beginning with the chanting of the holy names. Hare Krishna,
Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare.
Lord Chaitanya has made it very easy for all of us to be Krishna conscious in this Kali Yuga, that anyone and everyone can chant the holy names of the Lord and become God conscious. And we're told there is no other way to become God conscious in the Kali Yuga. Someone may be thinking God is light or God is fire. Someone is thinking there's no God. Everyone has so many different conceptions. But if we hear from the scriptures, then we get perfect knowledge. If we hear through the disciplic succession, then they're revealing to us the actual nature of the Absolute Truth. And the process is based on, first of all, submission, then inquiry and service. Lord Krishna had described in the previous verse, Tadvedi pranipatena. So transcendental knowledge reveals in the beginning, first of all, with pranipatena, that we have to be humble, we have to submit ourselves before the spiritual teachers. We have to inquire from the spiritual teachers, and we are meant to give service. Then they can reveal to us what is that truth. If there is no submission, if there is no inquiry, no service, then they will not reveal to us what is that truth. So Lord Krishna is describing to us, what is this message? What is the truth? That we are all parts and parcels of Lord Krishna. And we're all His. Just like we will see also in the at the end of the fifth chapter, Lord Krishna will speak the famous peace formula. Bhogdaram yajna tapasyam sarvaloka maheshwaram sudhodaram sarvabhutaram nyatvamam shanti vachate. Lord Krishna is describing how all of us can be peaceful. You know, we all want peace. The United Nations was created, was meant to bring peace. But Prabhupada said, just simply having a display of many colorful flags does not bring about peace. To get actual peace, we have to know the formula for peace. And Lord Krishna has stated it very well in the Bhagavad Gita in the fifth chapter, that we have to apply three principles. We have to know, first of all, everything belongs to Krishna. It is stated here that all living beings are in me and are mine. We also belong to Krishna. We're thinking, I'm independent, I'm free. No, we have our origin. We come from Krishna. Everything comes from Him. We also come from Him. So we have a relationship with Him. We belong to Him. Everything is His. And because we belong to Krishna, we are meant for His enjoyment, for His pleasure. We said, Krishna is the Purusha. We are the Prakriti. Our relationship with Krishna is like male and female. Krishna is the male and we are the female. We're all meant for His enjoyment. This is spiritual knowledge. Prabhupada gives spiritual mathematics. He said, Krishna plus everything is Krishna. Everything plus Krishna is everything. And Krishna minus everything is still Krishna. One plus one is one. And one minus one is still one. This is called spiritual mathematics. The impersonalists, Samayavadis, cannot understand how Lord Krishna can have so many forms. Just like here in our temple, some people become confused. They come and they see many different gods, and they think there are many gods. But actually, there are not many gods. There is one God, Ekala Ishwara Krishna, or Sabritya. There is only one Ishwara, one controller. Why are there so many gods here? They are simply all different forms of the one Supreme Lord. The Lord has many different forms. Just you and I can also put on different dresses and appear in different ways. Someone may put on you go to work and you put on some uniform, some dress of the company, and you go to play football, you put on some other dress, you go to play cricket, it's a different dress, you know. You come and do the pujari work, it's a different dress. But it's the same person, just in the same way. Lord Krishna is the one Supreme Lord, but he comes in many different forms, in many different incarnations. But he's the one Supreme Lord. Rama, Krishna, Balarama, Narsingha, Varaha, Matsya, Kurma. And there are so many different avatars of the Lord. As many as there are waves on the sea, there are incarnations of the Lord. But God is one. There is only one God. But he takes many different forms. Why? For the pleasure of his devotees. The different devotees desire to have relationships with him in different ways. Also for his pleasure. The Lord also is a person he likes to enjoy. Why do we change our dress and appear in different ways? We want to do different things. We have different activities. According to the work we're doing, the activities we're performing, we will dress in different ways. And in the same way, Lord Krishna appears in many different forms. Sometimes he comes as a fish. Sometimes he comes as a half man, half lion. Sometimes he comes as a dwarf. He's appearing in so many different situations, different positions within society in order to fulfill different purposes. But he is the one Supreme Lord. And he is never affected by these different incarnations. Srila Prabhupada explains how the impersonal Mayavadis cannot understand how Krishna can have so many different forms and at the same time maintain his individuality. They say, just like this book, if we take the pages out of the book, then the book is not complete anymore. In the same way, they think, if so many incarnations have come from Krishna, then Krishna must be reduced. They do not know that Krishna is Purnam. Om Purnam Ada Purnamidam Purnat Purnam Vadachate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vashishyate. This is spiritual mathematics. The personality of Godhead is perfect and complete. And even though so many complete units emanate from him, still he remains the complete balance. Whatever is produced of the complete whole is also complete in itself. Just like this world is a complete emanation from the Supreme Lord. We find everything here in this world for our maintenance, for our survival. Everything is arranged. Prabhupada gives a nice example how everything is provided for the Lord. He said, just like when a child is born. Now, when a baby is born, the only thing the baby can take is the milk of the mother. And as soon as the baby is born, immediately the milk of the mother flows to feed the child. This is an example of the potency of the Supreme Lord, how He is providing for all living entities. Everything is here, arranged in this one planet for our maintenance and survival. And who is providing it all? The Supreme Lord Krishna. So even though units have come from Him, He remains complete. We would all like to have a bank account like that. Wouldn't it be nice if our bank account was like Krishna? That you could take money out and it will still remain the same. Never get reduced, right? We could go on spending and spending and the money still remains the same. One devotee was telling me he came to Dubai and I said, oh, he was surprised that he spent so much money, everything was so expensive. He looked in his bank account, he was shocked he'd spent so much because he was using credit card everywhere. And then after a few days shopping, oh my goodness, he spent so much. No money left. Time to go home. So that is the material world that we take and it's reduced. But Krishna is Purnam. He is the complete whole. And even though you take from Him, He remains complete. This is the transcendental nature of the Supreme Lord. Ordinary people cannot understand. This is inconceivable. Did we ever see anything like this, that we're taking from it and it remains the same? Our bank account is not like that. The book is not like that. Our fridge is not like that. You take from the fridge, or you have to fill it up again, right? You eat all the food, everything you got there, and then you have to go shopping again and put more food in there. But there are examples, even in this world, of this kind of nature. For example, the sun every day is giving so much heat and light. We do not have a fire. You know, we build a fire, we have to put more fuel continually on the fire. But every day the sun is emitting so much radiation, so much heat, so much light. And it has been giving heat and light since the beginning of the creation, since millions of years. We never hear about the sun going out. The sun's burned out, used up all its fuel, no more heat left. Fortunately, the sun continues to give heat and light for the benefit of the whole universe. So even within this world, we see examples of this kind of potency. And that potency is there to perfection in the Supreme Lord Krishna. That He is the source of everything. Everything comes from Him. We are His parts and parcels, and He has so many incarnations which come from Him, but He remains the same, complete and perfect. We have to understand this knowledge. How can we understand it? Simply by hearing and by serving. Then Lord Krishna says, of course, to those, tesham satata yuktanam. To those who are constantly devoted to me and worship me with love, I give the understanding by which they may come to me. Krishna in the heart can give us that knowledge to understand these features of Krishna conscious philosophy. what is inconceivable becomes conceivable by the grace of the Supreme Lord. There is nothing beyond the power of the Supreme Lord Krishna. We are limited because we are tiny parts and parcels, but Krishna is the Supreme. He has inconceivable potencies. If we want to understand God, we have to accept that there is such a thing as achintya shakti, inconceivable potencies. In this example, in this regard, Srila Prabhupada narrates that very simple story about the brahmana and the cobbler. Right? The cobbler had faith in the Lord. The brahmana was a brahmana, but he was not a realized brahmana. And he met Narada Muni. And Narada Muni said, "I'm going to Vaikuntha to see Lord Narayan." So the brahmana said, "When you go there, ask Lord Narayan. Make sure this is my last life, that I'm the brahmana. So next birth I should get liberation. I should get my moksha. Make sure Lord Narayan knows about it, that he's ready to liberate me." And the cobbler heard that Narada is going. He said, "Oh, please ask Lord Narayan how many more births I will have in this world before I can get liberation." So then Narada Muni went to Vaikuntha and saw Lord Narayan, and he told him about these two persons, the brahmana and the cobbler. And Lord Narayan said, "Yes, I know these two." He said, "That brahmana, you tell him that he has to take many births before he will come back to me. But that cobbler, very soon he is coming back." So Narada Muni was surprised a little, but Lord Narayan said, "When you tell them this," he said, you tell them what I was doing, and you tell them that I was threading an elephant through the eye of a needle." So Narada Muni came back and he went to see the brahmana and the cobbler, and he told the brahmana was very happy, "Oh, you've come back from Vaikuntha. How is Lord Narayan? Is he ready for me coming there?" And Narada said, "Oh no." He said, "I'm sorry, I have to tell you, Lord Narayan said you're not coming there for many births." And the brahmana got angry. "What? What do you mean? I'm a brahman. I have to get liberation after this life. I'm the brahman by birth. I should get liberation in the next life. This should be my last birth. I don't believe you went to like Vaikuntha. I don't believe you ever met Lord Narayan. If you met Lord Narayan, you tell me, what was Lord Narayan doing when you went there?" So Narada Muni said, "Yes, he was threading the elephant through the eye of a needle." The brahmin said, "Just see, you crazy fellow. Get out of here. I'll beat you with my shoes. Stop wasting my time. Go and take some medicine. Something wrong with your mind. Threading an elephant through the eye of a needle. Who could ever imagine? Go away. Get out, quick." So then Narada Muni went to see the cobbler, and the cobbler said, "Oh, Narada Muni, how are you? Please come. Welcome to my home. Have a seat. Please take some water. How was Lord Narayan?" Oh, and then Narada Muni said, "Yes, very nice." He said, "When I met Lord Narayan, he was threading the elephant through the eye of the needle." And the cobbler said, "Ah, how wonderful my Lord is. Just think how great is Lord Narayan, that he can take the elephant through the eye of a needle." So Narada Muni said to the cobbler, he said, "Don't you think that is impossible? Do you really think that he could do that?" And the cobbler said, "Yes, why not? Definitely he can. Can you see? Look at this tree, this banyan tree. I'm sitting under this banyan tree every day, repairing the shoes. This banyan tree has come from a tiny seed. One tiny seed has produced this huge tree. So if from one tiny seed Lord Narayan can bring this huge tree, why can he not bring an elephant through the eye of a needle? The cobbler had realization, not that Brahman. The Brahman, he was Jati Brahman. He was not the real, he had no realization, no real understanding of the Achintya Shakti, the inconceivable power of the Supreme Lord. One who is devotee, one who has some bhakti for the Lord, he can understand the Achintya Shakti, the inconceivable powers of the Supreme Lord. So it's very easy for him to enter, to surrender to the Lord and to understand his powers. But for one who is in the material consciousness, who's thinking, I am body, I am Brahman, I am whatever, I am this, I am that, then we will never be able to get out of the illusion. This is ignorance. So this ignorance can be removed just by simply surrendering. By surrendering, submitting ourselves to the feet of the great devotees like Bhaktivedanta Swami Prabhupada and taking up his instructions to engage in service for Lord Krishna. Then everything can be revealed, one after another. So Narada Muni was happy to see this cobbler. One, birth is not very significant. Whatever position we're born in this material world, that is not the important thing. Prabhupada quoting one Bengali saying, Janami janami sabi pita mata pai, Krishna guru nahi mili bhaja hari ai. Everyone has got a mother and a father, every living entity, the pigs and the dogs, the fish in the sea, they all have their mother and father. But the fortunate living entity has got Krishna and Guru. And so they can get free from the material world. So we should understand how to make proper use of the human life to get this transcendental knowledge and make proper use of it to get out from the material world. Okay, Hare Krishna. Any question? Question? Comment? Very rare to get the human life, right? We say 8,400,000 different species of life. And only 4 lakh species are human species. So it's rare to get the human birth. So many different species. We're fortunate to have human body. But just to have the human body is not enough. We're very, very fortunate when we get the association of devotees. That is more rare, to get the association of devotees, because in the association of devotees we can cross over the ocean of birth and death. Bajahure mamna Shri Nandanandana Abhaya Charanara Vindurde
Bajahure mamna Shri
Bhajaru Re Mana Sri Nanda.
So Lochan Das Thakur is describing for us in this song how by this human form of life and the association of devotees we can cross over the ocean of material existence. We need that association. Only in the association of devotees can we cross over. It's not just because we have a human body, but when we're very fortunate, then we get the association of devotees. We have to value that. So many of you have come from faraway places to this place, and by the arrangement of the Supreme Lord Krishna, you came to the association of devotees. In the association of devotees, there will be the activities of devotional service, hearing, chanting, remembrance of Krishna. It's made easy in the association of devotees. Without that association, then it's very difficult. Material life. In Lochan Das Thakur describing the nature of material existence, how we have to work very hard, we have to tolerate so many different conditions, the heat and the cold, the wind, not much rain, but a lot of other things. We tolerate all of these things. For what purpose? Just for some, we have to serve wicked and miserly people just for some temporary flickering moments of sense gratification. So we understand this is not life. Life must be meant for something more than just some flickering pleasure of the senses. And when we are fortunate, then we will meet the devotees and we will be introduced to Bhakti Yoga, Krishna consciousness. We'll be given an opportunity to awaken to the higher purpose of life. Yeah, we don't want to just be like animals. Human life is meant for some real purpose. And we make proper use of this human life when we engage in the service of the Lord, which begins with hearing and chanting. This is the foundation of our Krishna consciousness. We have to hear. We have to hear from the proper source through the disciplic succession from the acharyas. They can guide us. They can deliver us from the material existence. If you take shelter of big scientists, big politicians, big philanthropists, big whatever they are, statesmen and so on, they will not save us from the miseries of life. They're also subjected to the threefold miseries. They're also being subjected to so many different pains and pleasures of material nature. But devotees are transcendental. Devotees are not under the control of the material nature. Devotees have surrendered to Krishna. One who has taken shelter of Krishna overcomes the material nature. Devihi esha gunamaihi
mamamaya durgya
ye prapanyante mayamikam karantide. When Krishna is saying this material nature very difficult to overcome, mamamaya durgya, very difficult to get free of the material nature. Yeah, we know how we're so attached, we have so many things, so many problems. It's very hard to get out, to get free. But once when we surrender to Krishna, come to Krishna, then it's very easy. Krishna frees us. Because the acharyas, the liberated souls, they are free. They are not entangled. They are not bound up by the material nature. They have freed themselves from the material nature. They easily cross over the ocean of material existence. And they can help us also to cross over. We just have to take shelter of their teachings, take shelter of their message. And then that ocean of material existence is reduced to the water contained in the hoofprint of the cow, an insignificant amount. We don't need any boat to cross over the water in the hoofprint of a cow. It's tiny, insignificant amount of water. But we're thinking, oh, material energy, material ocean is so vast, so difficult. But when we take shelter of Krishna, then it becomes insignificant. So this is Krishna consciousness. It's making everything very easy for us. Krishna says in Bhagavad Gita, I am easy to obtain, O son of Kunti, because of the constant engagement in devotional service. So this center is here to keep all of you constantly engaged in devotional service. And when we're constantly engaged, Krishna is easy to obtain. Thank you very much. Hare Krishna.